Please report to the front of the marching black and gold band section.
Oh, you in for a treat. Oh, yeah. I think Kate's over there somewhere. Where is she, Ken? On the 25. Is that her on the 25? Almost, yeah, she is. Fifth this way.
In class 4A competition, and our last band for competition this afternoon or this evening is the Fairhope High School Band from Fairhope, Alabama. Band director Steve Sims, assistant band directors Rick Faison and Ray Merlini, band captain Shelly Mosley, drum majors Cheryl Reed and Julie Harrison, color guard captain Mandy Welburn, and color guard co-captain Erica Bolden. Drum major Cheryl Reed and Julie Harrison, is your band ready? You may now take the field for competition.
Thank you. Very good. Very good.
You didn't just say that, did you?
No.
Concludes our competition for the evening. The Alpha High School Marching Black and Gold is on their way to perform for our exhibition. While they are on their way, let me make a few last-minute announcements. Let me thank some people one more time for helping us put on our Little Big Horn Marching Band Contest. Arts Music Shop, Tim, Sully, appreciate you. The guys from the city of Op,
let's go, Fairhope!
The field, electricity, thanks a lot. All the Op band boosters who have manned the concession stands. Hearts. Thank you.
Cut some on the end down there next to Fairhope.
One. Percussion. One. Band. One. 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 But overall, one. We now come to the Best of Class Awards.
I'm John Tesh.
And I'm Mary Hart. There are some surprising new disclosures to report in connection with the death of one of the country's favorite television stars, Amanda Blake. When Amanda Blake, Miss Kitty of Gunsmoke, died this year at the age of 60, it was announced that the cause was the cancer she'd been fighting for many years. But a copy of her death certificate shows the real cause of death, acquired immune deficiency syndrome, AIDS. Blake's doctor has been quoted as saying she did not contract the disease from a blood transfusion during her cancer treatment. But prior to Blake's death, her fifth husband, Texas real estate executive Mark Spaeth, was rumored to have died of AIDS. Blake kept her disease secret from all but her closest friend, an animal rights activist with whom she had lived during the last months of her life.
I'm disturbed because of the stigma that's attached to this. I think it's terrible that there is that. Amanda was a very moral person. She was not a promiscuous person. She was not a drug user. She was a very you know, extremely moral person.
Blake willed her entire estate to the animal rights group she worked with, but her family contested the will and, in doing so, discovered the death certificate bearing the actual cause of death. Those Blake worked with for animal rights say she had a clear vision as to how her assets might be used.
To have Amanda's assets would finish off an elephant project, for one thing, that she had been working on, and I think with some of the assets, it's going to make a couple of elephants a lot more comfortable, and that's what she was interested in.
Amanda cared about animals. That's what she spent her life doing. And the final years here, Amanda made great personal sacrifices to do things for animals. And I don't think that that should be washed down the tubes.
The number of women dying of AIDS is increasing rapidly, according to the National Center for Disease Control. The number of women aged 15 to 44 who died of AIDS complications rose 75% between 1986 and 1988.
The music of Elvis Presley touched millions around the world, but the people who Elvis touched personally are the ones who remember him best. Elvis Touched Me, our inside story for today. Millions of Elvis Presley's fans feel that he touched them in some way. Some were fortunate to have known him. Elvis was famous for giving elaborate gifts to his fans. In 1973, he gave Phyllis Miller of Kansas City, Missouri, a watch worth $40,000 as a thank you for her loyalty. She sat in the front row at hundreds of his shows, but she'll always remember the first time she met him.
I looked at him and couldn't resist it, ran my hand up and down his back, and he felt just like a sleek Black Panther, and we talked all night long that night.
Five-year-old Rhonda Williams of Monroe, Louisiana, received a jeweled cross from Elvis at a concert.
He took this cross off of his neck and put it on hers, and he kissed her again, and he said, baby, this is yours, and nobody can ever take it away.
Rhonda, now 20, and her family are looking to sell the cross to ease financial burdens.
It's hard for her to sell it or to think about selling it. I believe with all my heart that Elvis would want her to.
Perhaps the person whose life was most touched by Elvis was Dayton, Ohio teenager Priscilla Myers. She was a loyal fan who was stricken with cystic fibrosis. The young girl didn't know she was dying. In 1956, Elvis arranged for her to meet him backstage at one of his concerts. Her mother, Lucille, remembers.
Meeting Elvis, it was a dream come true because she had loved a guy for 2 years prior, and she just nothing could have happened more exciting for her. And like I said before, we did not know we were going to lose Priscilla. Elvis did not know this.
Elvis continued to correspond with Priscilla and sent her get-well notes. He sent her a telegram in the summer of 1957 that read, "I feel shook up about your being in the hospital. All the rest of us will be praying for you. Your pal, Elvis." Tragically, Priscilla died 2 months later, and Elvis felt her loss deeply. He sent a condolence telegram to her parents.
He gave us a lot of love because of the love he showed to Priscilla, but he had gave us a lifetime of memories.
But fans are not the only ones who had their lives influenced by Elvis. Joan Rivers is a star now, but earlier in her career, when she was playing Las Vegas, Elvis would come backstage to compliment her on her performance. This gave her added encouragement to pursue her career. Joan also got to see firsthand a very special side of the King.
And our children went to the same school. And as a matter of fact, they were in the same class. And he was a very good father. He would go to the meetings, which is, again, a camp. I mean, you'd go to the nursery school parents' day, and there would be Elvis sitting there with little Lisa Marie and Priscilla, and I'd be there with my husband. But he was a good father. He went to the things. There's only one
Mona Lisa. Country music star T.G. Shepherd was a close friend of Presley's. When he was just starting out in 1973, Elvis gave him his old tour bus so he could travel to his concerts in style.
I didn't want to accept the bus. I had always turned gifts down with Elvis because I had told him time and time again that all I ever really wanted from him was just his friendship. I think he knew that. But when the bus came, it meant so much to him to be able to help me start my career.
Although he's been gone for 12 years, Elvis's legacy to his millions of fans just might be everlasting. There are many stories about the generosity of Elvis Presley. While in the hospital, Elvis heard about another patient who needed surgery but couldn't afford it, so Elvis paid the bills. Elvis heard a news broadcast about a woman who lost her mobile home in a storm. Elvis bought her a new one. And a mechanic once stopped on the highway to help Elvis when his expensive car had stalled. Elvis paid off the mortgage on the mechanic's home. On our Inside Story tomorrow, Tonight's Show sidekick Ed McMahon goes public for the first time in an exclusive interview about his divorce.
It was painful, painful for Victoria. You know, we thought we had something great, and it fell apart, that's all.
Ed McMahon, the Inside Story tomorrow on Entertainment Tonight.
Coming up next, the premiere of the year at a bash in New York City, the Steel Magnolias steal the spotlight. And later, his talents transcended the music and brought the classics down to earth for all to enjoy. A tribute to the incomparable Horowitz.
Keep that great shower fresh feeling all day with Ban Solid.
Keep that shower fresh feeling all day.
I can't believe it. Don't you ever quit? I've been away a long time. And my roommate still...
And in your everyday struggles, some of you set goals, and sometimes you don't reach those goals. It may go a week, it may go a month, and you never reach that goal. But you can use our basketball team as some type of semblance, because we've struggled for 30, 31 years trying to win an NBA championship, so dreams do come true. On behalf of the Detroit Pistons, and myself, my family, and Joshua, this one is for the fans of Detroit.
Remote areas of the country can now be reached at the following number.
Craig, thank you very much. Well, the focus, Rick, has obviously been on Detroit this part of the night. Talk a little bit about the Knicks. They've changed some things around, especially on the coaching staff.
Well, yes, and Stu Jackson has spent the entire exhibition season trying to hone in the half-court offense of the New York Knicks. They felt that that was an area they were very, very deficient in last year. They spent a great deal of time doing that to the point where they really were forsaking their traps and their presses. They didn't